So this is basically just a showing in a, it looks like in a, on a cadaver, I hope, exposure of a renal vein and yeah, I know. But basically you can see the, this is actually the main renal artery, and you can see bifurcates, and you know the renal vein usually sits on top of it, and that usually actually always comes on your, I know you took your UCM at least, but always comes on your exams and sometimes on your USM at least step three, but you know your vein is anterior. And what is that going down? Are they, I guess they're labeled. You can see the ureter, right? That's one. That's one. One thing you always, you know, always be careful of the ureter when you're in that area, especially when it can be down to the pelvis, and particularly where, like if you're going to injure it for us as vascular surgeons in the pelvis, where? Common iliac. Where does it? Where they usually cross?
That's
how
we're talking about the ureter.
Mm-hmm. Where?
Like in the inlet, like when it gets into the
pelvis. Like, give me. Like
the bifurcation.
Usually it's at the bifurcation into the internal and external, right? And is it on top or underneath? On top, right? So usually it's on top. So that's one, these are like one of the areas, you know. So especially if you guys are doing redo, for redo surgery, like anything else, neck, any place, redo surgery, you have no idea where it's going to be. I mean, I've had patients, I'm doing carotid surgery, who had neck fusion posterior, and you see the vagus on top of the carotid. So things happen for like, you have no idea why. So so what you can do to identify it? Stent it. You put the urethral stent before your surgery. So if you have a difficult case, you know, so make sure you put urethral stents. And then the urethral stent, I mean, what does it basically do? I mean, not necessarily these are the data from vascular surgery, but from general surgery. Why, when you put urethral stents, does it help you actually avoid injuring it, or what does it help? Identify it, recognize it. Actually, it doesn't. Studies for like colon resections show that it doesn't help actually reducing it. It just helps identifying it. And if you're going to have to repair it, how would you repair a ureter? We had to do it once. We couldn't wait on the GU. It took forever to come. So how would you repair it? How would you repair your ureteral injury? Let's say it's a partial, not full thickness injury.
So with the stitch.
So with the stitch, okay? All right. So usually you put something called like a J, like over a J tube. Basically, you put it on each end, and then you do interrupted, like 7-0 interrupted sutures, so you don't necrose the anastomosis or your suture line, and you just leave it in, and then you come back and take out the stent. So basically, there's a, it's called a J stent or something. So this is the psoas muscle. How would you know it's a psoas muscle? Location, okay, what else? What sits on top of it? It's a little bit, yeah, it's a little bit more like medial to it, but yeah, what else? Some nerves? Genitofemoral nerve, and genitofemoral, iliofemoral nerve, right? So that's how we identify. So when you do retroperitoneal exposure, which we'll do on the cadaver, so we'll show you. So that's one thing, when you start mobilizing the retroperitoneum, right? I mean, first thing you're gonna see is the psoas muscle. You say, okay, I'm in. And then you just keep mobilizing, and then you identify your vessels and stuff like that, so. Well, that's a busy slide. So we talked about, earlier with Dr. Lums about the variations in the SMA and the celiac artery. So let me see what else can we talk about, which we didn't talk about earlier. Well, we talked about the relationship, right? We talked about the relationship between the vein, what we talked about nutcracker syndrome. So you can see how it can be easily compressed. So typically, like we said, we just basically clamp it. You can remove a small piece of the cava with the vein, so you can have enough length to bring it down. And then usually you're going to have to take, which vein is this? Adrenal. That's the adrenal vein. You're going to have to take a ligator, so you can pull the vein down and do a tension-free anastomosis and do it somewhere here. Sometimes you have also to take the gonadal, but usually I try to preserve it if I can. Actually, especially this last girl I did, the reason that, you know, I was made sure that we left it because she also, you know, she had severe compression of left iliac vein, which is called May Turner. So that's what she has, she's 14. So, you know, obviously we didn't do anything about it, but kind of educate the patient and the family that this is a potential problem also. So she had both, compression of both this vein and the iliac vein. So, so SMA, what are the branches of the SMA? Without looking, real quick. Okay, what else?
Ilio and digital
branches and the iliocolic. Okay. All right. So, so which patient? Let's say you can do an EVAR on a patient, and the patient had colon resection. Who cares? Are you gonna ask more? Which side is? That's a good question, right? If it's left side, usually it's not a big deal, right? Because you're gonna cover the IMA usually, right? But if it's extended, right? Because you could have, I mean, the SMA and the IMA will have some communication through the colic vessels, right? But if they had the right colon removed, that might be an issue, right? Because now you're covering the IMA, and then they might have, I mean, it's not necessarily like it's an issue, but something you have to like think about and be careful, you know, maybe admit the patient, go examine them, make sure they don't have any ischemic colitis. But sometimes if they remove the iliocolic, and you know, middle colic, and you name it, then the more they remove, then the higher chances that you might have some issues with by covering the IMA with an EVAR. So just something to think about, you know, when you see these patients in clinic. But even in general, like if you're doing an EVAR on a patient, you're right, you want to look at those vessels. You look at the celiac, we look at the SMA, at the IMA, right? Because you're going to cover the IMA and make sure the SMA is fine and the celiac RT is fine. Was it you or Alan had the case? Actually, a patient came in, was having... No, after. Not from us. Yeah, I know, not you. But a patient had an EVAR from us, and then he kept having postprandial pain, and no one could figure it out. And then finally, what turned out to be, he had actual SMA stenosis, high-grade SMA stenosis. His celiac was fine, but now the IMA is covered with an EVAR. He was lucky he didn't have a major complication, right? So they were able to go in, basically stented his SMA, and he did fine. But just to show you, I mean, it's real. It could happen. So if you're going to expose the SMA, how would you expose it? You guys know? Have you guys been in the lab? Yeah, maybe it's too much. But basically, so what is this picture doing? What's holding up? The transverse colon. So you hold the transverse colon, you pull it up towards the head, right? And some people actually... they go after the middle colic. They feel the middle colic and they trace it all the way down, and then you know they kind of try to identify the SMA this way, or you basically just dive into the base of the mesenter, right? That's your base of the mesenter here. Basically, you kind of make an incision like this and take your time and exposing the SMA and find it at the base of the mesenter. So I mean that's one way of doing it. Where would be the SMV be? To the right, yeah. So the best way to remember is that the SMV, IMV, SMV and SMA, same thing like the cava and the aorta, kind of have similar orientation. So that's why I remember it, you know. So I know the venous is on the right side of the patient, so. All right. So if you do... some of the collaterals, you know, you have, IMA is occluded or something, and but it's still filling. How would you, what are the two collaterals that would fill the IMA from the SMA? Marginal artery of Drummond, and what else? Myocardial. How would you know which one is which on angiogram? Or let's say you're exposing a patient and they have it. Look at the arcuvial line. It's centrally located, right? The other one is more like at the periphery. All right, that's how you differentiate between the two. And that's actually, I don't know if we have some angios, but it's pretty impressive. So when you're doing aneurysm surgery, is one of the teaching that people talk about is that when you ligate the IMAs, you want to ligate it from the inside. And the idea is that you don't want to, you know, if you ligate it from the outside, sometimes you might knock some of these branches, some of these collaterals into the IMA, that could be devastating complications. So So the teaching is always when you open up the aneurysm, you oversaw the IMA from the inside. So you don't have to worry about an outside and damage any of the collaterals to the IMA.
Earlier, so when we do, I mean, a lot of what we do aortic-wise is endovascular now, obviously, but when you do open surgery, whether it's for occlusive disease or aneurysmal disease, one thing you need to remember is some anomalies that are very important in terms of how you clamp the aorta. So the left renal vein can be posterior to the aorta. And if you don't realize that up front, you can have an unforgivable injury. So that's something that's about 30% of cases, it can be posterior to the aorta. Important to know and important to look at on the CT beforehand. It's something a lot of people tend to not to focus on, but it's important to focus on. Then replaced right paddock is actually more common as well.
Yeah, I think we talked about that. I think Dr. Lamson mentioned briefly the what we call circumaortic left renal vein or completely retrograde retroaortic renal vein, which you know is the most common venous anomaly that we see. I mean, that was actually on my boards. You know, you put a clamp, you remove the clamp, and there's blood everywhere. It was actually coming from a retroaortic renal vein.
It was actually on my cases.
Yeah. So yeah. So always on. So that's the thing. When you look at cancer, we look at everything. You know, just. Look at everything, especially how you're gonna clamp it and all the stuff. So, trying to avoid the complication is always good. So, so again, here basically just showing you the arc of Lyon is more centrally located, and the marginal artery of Drummond is more like at the periphery. So, basically, we're just talking about the collaterals, and we talked here about the collaterals from the celiac to the SMA, right through. The GDA and the pancreatic duodenal, right? Again, I mean, this is basically just an angiogram showing you a really robust GDA. So again, like what Dr. Lamza was saying, you know, the case he was talking about, there was an aneurysm. If the aneurysm here, you can actually ligate it, you don't have to repair it, right? In most patients, because if you have a nice GDA, you should be able to still perfuse the liver, but if the aneurysm goes further in, especially across the GDA, then you have to do something about it. You have to repair it or something.
The other thing is also remember that the hepatic artery only supplies about 25% of the blood flow to the liver, right? It's mostly from where?
Portal vein.
Yeah.
Why do you have to, because if someone has mesenteric ischemia, oftentimes they don't, if the celiac is included, they just leave it and just, you know, restore flow through this SMA. But how come if they have aneurysm?
So if you have mesenteric ischemia and you both have celiac and SMA occluded, you bypass both, you're saying?
No, well, the way I've seen it is only they only restore flow to the
So SMA. not really. So if you're doing elective, again, this is, I guess, gets more advanced, but since you talked about it, so if you're doing an elective mesenteric, elective for mesenteric ischemia, chronic mesenteric ischemia, it's actually better to revascularize both, okay? Celiac and the SMA. But if it's an emergency, you know, patient came with acute mesenteric ischemia and they're sick, you want to get them off the table, you just want to do a quick bypass, you just do one to the SMA and get them off the table. So, but in elective situations, it's actually better to do both. Well, now that's your venous anatomy now. So, so real quick, without cheating at the picture, so IMV drains into splenic, and then becomes straight into the portal.
Choose one. Choose the victim.
Yeah.
Joins with the superior mesenteric vein.
Okay, and then becomes portal vein. Okay, that's very good. So, and then like what Dr. Bismuth was saying, I mean, that's one of the main supply for the liver, right? The artery is like 20-something percent, and this is like 70-80%.
That's that branch coming right in, just above the splenic SMB confluence.
I guess so.
Yeah, what's that?
Yeah,
left gastric vein, something called the corny vein. It becomes very important in portal hypertension.
Yeah. So if you guys ever do a liver transplant, actually this is the coronary vein becomes really huge in these patients, and because of the portal hypertension that they have. So this will talk about some of the, how you can expose the mesenteric vessels at the base of the mesentery, right? So you have the transverse colon, cephalad, and basically the colon, the bowel either pushed down a little bit to the side, and you can just dive into it and expose it there at the base of the mesentery. So which we do, we'll probably do some of those exposures later today.
There's your collaterals off the left renal vein we're talking
about. Oh, yeah. So I guess, yeah, there's a splenic vein here, yeah. That's actually the splenic, yeah.
So one of the now obsolete operations is distal splenic.
Oh, yeah, distal splenic vein shunt, yeah.
And for a patient with portal hypertension, so the original operation was a portal cable shunt. You can't see the cave up because it was behind the portal vein and the superior mesenteric vein. So it started off portal cable shunt. Problem is all the blood goes into the cable and short circuits the liver. And actually, those patients, you know what happened? Why does the blood go into the liver in the first place?
No.
Yeah, I get these detoxified. So you'd shunt this stuff into the periphery, stop the bleeding from the varices, and the varices are being pressurized from the corny vein. And so it would stop the bleeding, but they become totally confused. And so then they tried to make selective shunts. So they put a shunt in between the superior mesenteric vein and the inferior vena cava, and then decrease the size of the shunt. So you try to make it semi-selective by using an interposition graft that was 10 millimeters. So you maintain antegrade flow up to the liver, and you decompress from a pressure standpoint at the same time. And that kind of works pretty iffy. And then a guy called Dean Warren and Atef Salam developed what's called the distal splenorenal shunt, where you dug the splenic vein out of the pancreas. Well, that's a nightmare scenario because you got portal hypertension, you got all these collaterals and the things embedded in the pancreas, and half the time they've got pancreatitis. Somebody said you just turned a good operation into a great operation. Man, it was bloody. And so you'd divide the splenic vein distally and swing it down onto the left renal vein. And that was actually a semi-selective shunt that you would create. And so you try to, avoid the patient, the confusion that occurs with it, and decompress at the same time.
Yeah, I don't know. We never hardly done any of these operations when I was in training, but I don't know. Did they even come on the boards? Did they ask them on the boards? I don't think so.
Along came TEPS, and almost within a couple of years, it was hardly ever done.
Yeah, So, I guess this is, we're talking about some of the drainage for the stomach. So this is, again, the coronary vein and the left gastric. This is the what we call the gastroepiploic. And again, the artery follows next to the gastroepiploic artery. Again, from a historic sample, they used to take some of those and use them for CABG. I don't think they were had miserable results, but these are the they used to actually take them, believe it or not, and use them for CABGs.
The hepatic veins are kind of interesting is that there's a bunch of other branches that come out the front of the inferior vena cava into the back of the caudate lobe of the liver. And so there are a bunch of branches called caudate branches. And you can actually mobilize the liver all the way up to the hepatic veins, but you're pulling up in the liver, pulling down on the cave. You have these little short branches that you're trying to divide and ligate without evulsing them at the same time. But you can actually take those all the way up. And if you're dealing with, for example, a renal tumor that's growing up the cave, that's what you have to do. You can mobilize the liver, take down the left lobe of the liver, and get a clamp below the level of the hepatic veins, and then open the liver up all the way.
Yeah, again, if you have some tumors, some of these tumors extend into the cave, into the hepatic veins, so knowing where, that's very important, right? Whether you're going to have to, put these patients on, atrial venous or venous bypass, and where you're going to clamp. Should you mobilize, the suprahepatic cava, which is really not, if you think about it, it's not that much, right? I mean, you mobilize the liver, and you probably have just that much cava before, it dives into the chest. And then you have your infrahepatic cava. But these are the things you have to look for. We had a case we got called into, where actually the tumor embolized and now it's in the right atrium. So we had to go angiovac.
Did they come out?
Most of it, not all of it. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
In the atrium?
In the atrium, yeah.
Can you point out the crust, the median arcuate ligament? We talked about that a little bit earlier.
Well, here, there you go. So this is, see, it's coming up and down, again, around the celiac artery. So it's very thick. So when you're in that, dissecting that area, I mean, it's not that, and also the sympathetic ganglion, they're not, I mean, people think, oh, I'm already in the adventitia. It's not. Actually, they're very, very thick tissue that you're going to have to really release to get all the way down to the aortic tissue. But this is a, this is your, you know, the cruise and coming around it. On the side too, so and it goes all the way down to the SMA. So it's a long fiber.
Yeah, let me point out one other thing. So, is the anatomy of the greater mandum matter to you? Do we ever use the mandum?
Yeah.
So there's a bunch of things on there. I mean, number one is retropancreatic tunnels. If you're going to do a bypass from the supraceliac aorta. Well, there's no supraceliac aorta there. You've got to basically divide the diaphragm. When you divide the diaphragm there, you're really up in the chest. I mean, that's descending, anatomically, that's descending thoracic aorta. Usually it's disease-free. And typically you're going to saw a bifurcated graft on there. A lot of people tunnel it behind the pancreas. That's fairly bold, and it's a little anxiety-provoking sticking your fingers behind the pancreas because that's where the splenic vein is. So you do this, and you look to see if there's a bunch of blood pouring out of the hole. You do this, then you do it from the bottom. And so that's one of the issues that you've got there. The other issue with the, and you can see the cutaway where the pancreas has been cut away, you're trying to tunnel behind the splenic vein in front of the aorta, and it's a little scary doing that, because I don't know how you fix that if you got a big hole in the splenic vein. And the second thing is the omentum we use not infrequently for covering grafts. So with the abdominal policeman, you want to show the pedicle and you can swing it on down.
So, I mean, actually the last mesenteric bypass, you know, I got lucky, but, you know, we're able to tunnel because, I mean, I don't want to, and that lady, I can't remember why, but basically, you know, for some reason, she was easy dissection her, so we're able to basically go from top and below and pass the clamp, and we're able to do the bypass. And what's nice about it, once you tunnel the bypass, you're sitting there, you know, and you just basically plug it to the SMA, and be done with it, so. What was the other thing you asked me, that comes in?
The momentum.
Yeah. Is there another picture to show how?
I don't think so. I'm not sure. This is just all mainly.
Yeah, portal stuff. So, like how do you swing it, or how do
yeah,
you?
There's blood supply and the momentum's coming in two different directions, and typically it's pretty unsophisticated. Typically, you hold up the momentum and you look for windows that are in the momentum. Window is transparent, and you can split the momentum. Almost up to the, we tend not to divide the gastric deployed. And then you can actually tunnel that down through the transverse mesocolon down into the retrocolic compartment and lay it on the front of the aortic graft. And so it's one way of trying to isolate it if we're worried about infection down there. It's another way of trying to stop it eroding into the duodenum, because you see where the third and fourth parts of the duodenum are, lies right on top of the aorta, right there. And that's where your proximal anastomosis is when you sew a graft in there. Even with endografts, you know, endografts, one of the complications is aorta duodenal fistula. And these things can erode into the back of the duodenum, and that's where it erodes. So one thing you can put a piece of momentum between the graft when we're doing it open in the duodenum is to try and prevent that from actually happening.
Another thing here actually is that you don't appreciate, you think you're looking at the cava and the cruise when you open that up, but there's something overlying it, which is the left lobe of the liver, right? So you need to take that left lobe of the liver down, and when you take it down, one of the things you worry about is the hepatic veins, because those, if you get into those, that's big trouble. Really, the only way to get control of that properly, if you really tear it, is up in the chest.
Yeah, it's a problem. Mm. And it's deep. I mean, again, Netter does great illustrations. Is clearly not a surgeon. So, for example, if you ever put a retractor on and yank back on the spleen like that when we're in there, we're going to freak, because the next thing you're going to evulse the spleen, there'll be a big hole in the spleen. I mean, you almost never put a retractor unprotected like that on the front of the spleen, because it'll just rip it apart. And, you know, getting down to that crust of the diaphragm, I mean, I had a case last week, the patient mentioned that had the hepatic aortic aneurysm, and my plan was to do an aortohepatic bypass. I mean, this thing was so deep, it was terrifying, actually, even dividing the crust, and to try and sew an anastomosis. So we had to completely change the inflow just based upon the fact that the guy's pretty back. I mean, in a skinny person, you know, you're working in a hole. It's
Yeah, but we'll show you. I mean, we'll show you how to use some of the momentum, I mean, and to mobilize it.
This is why I give you this part.
Yeah. Is it, well, I'm trying to get, so is it just, I guess it's just variations. Yeah, variations of different, you know, left gastric vein. And honestly, I don't know the percentages of them, but basically just showing you how the different variations and drainage.
So we divide the inferior mesenteric vein all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, typically when you're doing the exposure of abdominal aorta, often it comes right across the front of the field, and you can divide and ligate that.
Thoracic.
Well, that's easier.
Yeah, I know. All right, so maybe. So let's see. something we didn't talk about, because you already talked about the thoracic stuff. So you talk about the, I guess, you know, the ascending. So what is this? I guess are they labeled? Are they labeled?
They are, but you can't
read. Yeah. So what is this coming around here? Kind of flipping around. Yeah. What is it? Recurrent laryngeal. Okay. How about on the, so is this left side or right side? Left. What about on the right side? Where does it go on the right?
Proud,
so yeah.
What are you saying?
On the right side clavian. Very good. So, I mean, that's important, right? When you're doing, you know, open aortic surgery, even, you know, this is, it seems like we're everything is stenting and stuff. But, you know, a lot of times when you're trying to put a clamp, I mean, when you're coming from that, like you do, you go through the fourth intercostal space, I mean, a lot of times you can actually put a clamp either distal to the subclavian or kind of between if you have room. So you obviously have to be careful, because you could easily injure, you know, the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And with your
patient comes in and you know, has an aneurysm in the chest and has hoarseness, you already have some ideas about what exactly is happening, right? You know that the recurrent laryngeal nerve is being affected.
Yeah.
So that's you know, a good clinical clue.
Yeah. How about this nerve? Phrenic. Okay. And these are your intercostals here.
Phrenic.
Yeah.
Only nerve in the body do what?
No, he's asking in the neck.
We might see it.
Yeah. Yeah, very good.
Good. Yeah. Crosses the anterior scalene muscle.
Yeah.
So when you're doing a subclavian artery exposure up in the neck, in order to get there, you've got to divide the anterior scalene muscle, and the phrenic nerve runs across the front of it. And while everything else up here is running medial to lateral, it's running lateral to medial across the front of the scalene muscle.
Yeah.
What are you going to see on chest x-ray if you injure the phrenic nerve on your carotid subclavian bypass?
Very good. Again, for the, so what are those two structures here, venous structures? Brachus valley coming in and forming the superior vena cava. So if you're doing, you know, again, like our guys here will be doing some cases with the cardiac guys, and sometimes, you know, if you have to do, you know, you're going to do some debranching, so we can do a bite-siding clamp on the ascending aorta. So you usually want to tunnel underneath, right, underneath your left innominate vein and bypass it to the innominate artery. Let's see, what else can we talk about? What's that?
The middle one.
Oh, right. Yeah.
The azygos and the hemiazygos, as you also look at occlusion in the IVC, some ileal cable occlusion as well.
So arterial anatomy is pretty straightforward. Venous anatomy can be incredibly difficult, especially in occlusions, because everything kind of reroutes, and you may think you have no idea exactly what it is. When you go back, can you go back one for a minute? So the other thing is the intercostal spaces. And so it's rolling. Where does the pedicle run?
Oh, yeah.
Underneath the rib, okay? Not a, so when you're going to put a chest tube in, you're going above the rib below, not below the rib above. You stay away from nailing that because these things bleed like the devil when that actually happens. Yeah. So you want to stay away from it.
Again, so showing the
other thing is, you know, pulmonary, arterial, and venous anatomy. It was kind of irrelevant to us up until recently. And so we're doing more and more and more things inside the pulmonary arterial circulation. And so one of the beauties of your specialty is we can morph in a variety of different directions because we've got the tools and the imaging to do it. And so, you know, we're now spending time trying to learn the different branches of the pulmonary arteries because we're the guys basically who are doing all the pulmonary arterial interventions at the moment. And so this now becomes very relevant.
All right, you guys heard of this artery of Adamikowitz? Yeah. Which segment of the aorta are that? Which part typically?
T5.
To where? T6, T5. Yeah, sure. To. Yeah, anywhere between like
T1 and
yeah.
T12.
Yeah, yeah. Anywhere like between, I guess, you know, T6, T12, you know, I mean, there's a lot of studies being done, try to identify the ahead of time, MRI, angiograms, but basically the importance of that, because, you know, obviously if you cover it, one of the complications for TVARS is around a spinal cord ischemia, right? So there's a lot of people trying to identify it. That's why people think that we should stay, if you can stage these operations, you know, to build some of these collaterals will be helpful. Again, I know Dr. Lumsden mentioned earlier about the vertebral artery, so you can see the anterior spinal coming in. So that's where also the vertebral plays a role, right, in protecting the spinal cord, right? So you have the anterior spinal artery, you have the intercostals, including the arterial ligaments. And then also in the pelvis, right, the internal iliac artery also plays a major role also in supplying the spine too. So all these, when you're looking at patients, you know, try to, you know, I mean, we can always do stuff, right? That's one fun of vascular. I want to put a stent here, I want to do this, you know, the residents get, you know, all excited about it. Now, one of our fellows, he loves to use the word interesting. Everything is interesting to him. So it is, but you have to think about it. I mean, yeah, if you're going to plug an internal iliac artery and you know, do a TVAR all the way up, I mean, you're gonna jack the risk of paraplegia. So try to see what you can do to preserve and maybe stage so you can actually try to reduce the risk of paraplegia.
How do you reduce the risk of paraplegia? You're gonna put a stent graft in the descending thoracic aorta, the patient's got an aortic dissection. Okay, so where does it go? It shows the spaces on that diagram.
Yeah.
You're going to put it in the subarachnoid space where the CSF is. And you got to put it in between those spinous processes. You usually put in, you know, as the lumbar drain that goes in, and you feed these catheters up superiorly into that space. And it's not without its risk. So one of the reasons that the anesthesiologists don't want to do it, if we forget to stop the Plavix and we forget to put their aspirins, because they're all bunch of little blood vessels. And what they're worried about is epidural hematomas, that they nail some of these blood vessels, you get bleeding and it compresses this.
But given also the space Dr. Lumsden mentioned, what is one of the other risks is if you drain too much, what can happen is you can get a subarachnoid bleed. That's also something else to be concerned about.
As you'll discover, there's lots of things to be worried about.
Yeah. Yeah.
Despite that, patients tend to survive us. Yeah. I don't want to
go back. We'll go back for...
Yeah, we've talked about that.
Yeah, call the guy, well... yeah, basically, you know, some of the Dr. Lums, Dr. Brisbane was talking about earlier about, you know, some of these collateral pathways, especially if you have, you know, interruption of the superior vena cava or inferior vena cava, but you always have to look for these collaterals. The intercostals become also very important. The thyrocervical trunk also becomes another important pathway in addition to the azygos system. So
can you tie off the left common iliac vein?
Andrew. So
if
yes or no. Yeah, yes or no. Yeah. All right. Choose one. Start
with Travis. It's odd. All right, Travis.
I'll say yes.
Okay.
Why?
Yeah.
You're looking at it right there.
Is that not a collateral pathway?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you can, it's not ideal, but you get away with it. You may have a big swollen leg, but leg's usually not going to fall off. What about infrarenal cava? Well, coming your way.
I'd say that not the ideal.
Not ideal. Not true.
Well.
Not the ideal.
So having said that, it used to be the old treatment for DVT is ligation of the IVC.
Call it interruption, or interruption of the cava.
Yeah,
so just basically.
Yeah, for a long time, an IVC filter placement was called. It was the code was actually interruption of the IVC.
Used to be a thing called a mix clip. It was a plastic clip that had teeth on it that you put around the cava, and it would clip like this. And the idea was it broke it up into like multiple different channels that would, but basically it was an occlusive device. It always went on in thrombose, but patients tolerated it. Left renal vein.
Left renal vein.
Yeah, we talked about that one.
Yeah.
All right, right renal vein.
Right, right about the right vein.
Right renal vein.
You can ligate it?
No.
Well, if you can ligate the left, you might as well ligate. Yeah, I mean, why not? If you ligate the left, you can ligate the right.
The only difference is there's no gonado coming off the left, or the right side. The gonado on the right side comes out of the cava.
Mm-hmm.
So you've only really got one major collateral. That's the suprarenal vein, which may or may not be adequate. So they're not equal.
Yeah. They're not equal, yeah. So usually the left is more forgiving, right? Because you have more drainage of the left renal vein than on the right side, right? Because the right side, the gonadal goes on the right side straight into the cava, right? On the left side goes all the way up to the renal vein. How about popliteal vein?
Yeah.
You can ligate it? No, not really. It's not as forgiving. So if you have a trauma with public vein, you probably want to try to repair it actually.
Right jugular. Can you tie off the right jugular vein?
Sure.
Yeah. Can you tie off right and left jugular vein at the same time? Yeah, probably not.
Probably.
If you get away with that, you're lucky. You're probably not a great idea.
Yeah.
Keep going.
Porto cable. I guess some venous anatomy. So, I mean, again, that's something, big when you do open aortic surgery. So this is what we talk about, what we call the circumaortic, right? Where you have the left renal vein basically going around both anterior and posterior to the cava. This is a retroaortic left renal vein. This is, we can have left-sided IVC. And then actually, which is more common, and it's almost the same. I can't remember, this was like 4-3% range. But anyway, it's not uncommon to see bilateral left and right IVC. So let's say a patient has a DVT and has a PE. What are you going to do? And you found out that he has bilateral IVC.
Can
anticoagulate?
Yeah.
You got to filter more superiorly.
So you can do that. So what's the problem with that? Thrombosis, thrombosis, I guess, with any spot, but what's the problem when you go higher and put a filter higher? Why? I mean, you're almost there, but why? Why? How big? Do you guys know how big? There's actually, we do, there's some recommendations, IFU, but I know we, as vascular surgeons, we like to go outside this IFU and use it, but I think the most recent filter now is 30 millimeters. Used to be 28. I think now the Cook expanded to 30. Even though, sometimes I personally don't routinely measure, but if I take a picture and see I have a huge cava, I might measure it before I put a filter in, just because if it, you know, especially with respiratory variations, right, it's going to expand, and then you might have problems with filter migration. And that's why some of these hooks help also, so it doesn't migrate and move on these filters. But the problem up there is going to be huge, and you might not have a good, you know, you might have tilting of the filter, migration. So what can you, what else, so what can you do? Two filters, yeah. Sounds crazy, but yeah, right? I mean, you have to do it to protect the patient, right? I mean, you put a filter, one in each cava. And usually these are sizable cava. They're not like small. They're usually pretty sizable. I've only seen one. I mean, I don't know. But usually they're pretty sizable size cava. And then one thing is, again, there's also variations on this one. Usually the most common is this, where actually the left, again, has something to do with embryology, which I'm not very good at. Dr. Lamson might make fun of me for saying that, but the left IVC actually could this is the most common variation, where it actually drains into the left renal vein, or actually they might form a confluence, go up and form a confluence with the right and left, and then basically drain into, I guess, the joint just below the left renal vein.
Again, the retro aortic left renal vein helps and hurts us when we're doing aortic surgery at the same time. Okay, so first of all, it makes the exposure up to the level of the renal arteries pretty easy. But the way you put a clamp on that, typically when you dissect out of the aorta, you don't dissect it out circumferentially. Usually you're looking at the front wall and you've dissected on both sides, and you put a clamp. And the way, and if you've got the aorta, let's say the aorta, this is the aorta. Mm. When you dissect it out, you put your fingers on either side of it and you feel the spine. Okay, you know you're all the way down the spine. And then we put a clamp on in the same direction. And you clamp this. And typically, I was always taught to wiggle a little bit to make sure that it wasn't attached to the front of the spine, because then it doesn't close the clamp. And so you put it on, wiggle it. Well, that's where that renal vein is. And so the concern, if you don't recognize that, is that if you jam these clamps in the front of that retroaortic renal vein and clamp it, it rips the thing anterior in a way, in a place that is very difficult to get.
All right. Let's see.
Variations.
Yeah, variations. So duplication. Yeah. So duplication of femoral RTM. Now, you know, as you guys know, we're dropping the word superficial. Because, you know, I can tell you how many times when I was in training, we see patients being anticoagulated when they have a saphenous vein thrombus versus, you know, superficial femoral, and they just send home with nothing because it's superficial, right? It's not the deep system. So we basically now drop the word superficial, especially from the venous system. But, you know, you can have duplication of the popliteal artery. That's not uncommon when you're exposing the biliary pulp to see two popliteal veins. And then, let's see. Absent posterior. I don't think I've ever seen one.
Pretty uncommon.
Yeah.
Not uncommon to see high bifurcation.
Correct.
Or pretty uncommon.
Yeah. But, you know, we refer to the tibial trifurcation. Actually, it's not a true trifurcation. I have a picture of one, beautiful, like all three coming at the same level. I probably should add it to the talk. But we refer to it as trifurcation, but it's not really true trifurcation. The true trifurcation, we see it probably 15-20% of the patients. But you have the AT, right? The AT comes off usually first and has this kind of acute, you know, like angle that you won't really miss it. And then you have the TP trunk, right? And then you have the peroneal and the posterior tibial. All right. So what we're looking at here. So I guess that's the, so this is the right common iliac. And you have your right internal. Right external, and then the internal iliac artery. So what, can you name some of the branches of the internal iliac artery?
Obturator.
So obturator, okay, very good, that's one. What else?
Pudendal,
okay. Can you guys able to see it? And I can hardly read it. Gluteal, very good, yeah. So what's the communication between the internal and the hyper and the profunda? Is there a communication there?
Aorta.
Let's say you shut down the hypogastric artery. What are some of the complications if you shut down the hypogastric?
Erectile dysfunction.
Yes. Okay. Erectile dysfunction. What else? Bladder claudication. That's very good. Okay. What else? In particular. Yeah, left colon. So now you mentioned that. So how is that communication? I mean, how is that contributing to the
inferior rectal comes off of the
inferior. So what about? So let's start with the superior. So what comes? So let's start with the IMA. What are the branches of the IMA? Left colic, okay, sigmoidal, and the superior rectal. So there's superior, there's inferior, and there's also middle, right? So, and then, so what are those? What are the inferior and the middle? Where do they come off? Okay, and then also you have some of the pathway which we call the cruciate pathway, which also, you know, basically you see, you know, again, I have a lot of images I should bring up, show to you, but you know, basically the internal iliac artery filling the profunda from the cruciate pathway. So it's not an easy dissection. So if you need, if you really need to get to the anterior and posterior, you know, branches of the hypogastric artery, it's not an easy, especially from the pelvis. So a lot of times, if we have to do that, we actually mobilize the left colon. So you mobilize the colon, you know, medially from either side, and that will actually take you really down. You can see the bifurcation of the hypogastric nicely, in much, much better way. So,
can I point out one thing in there? See that funky little thing coming up anteriorly to the patient's left, called the inferior epigastric artery.
Is it on the picture?
When does that become relevant to what we're doing?
Is it in the next picture?
Oh,
or
it's
do you see?
To the left. Go back.
Yeah.
See the inferior epigastric.
Yeah, I was going to say if we also show it in a better picture.
Where does that go? Say again? Compared where? Where does it connect? So it connects, runs north and south, where? Inside the rectus sheath. Okay, so you got a patient that comes along, they've been coughing forever, and they get acute abdominal pain. And you examine them, you're on call, you get the consult, and you got to call us and say, yeah, well, this patient has got acute abdominal wall pain. He's got a tender lump that we can sometimes feel, although they're kind of in spasm. And the hemoglobin dropped a little bit, but it's kind of stabilized, but they're really hurt. What are you going to do next? Next test. It's probably a CAT scan. Although you can diagnose it with a... And so a CAT scan, let's say you get a CAT scan, you will see rectus sheath on the left side, which is the normal side, rectus sheath on the right side, which is all plumped up like this. And it's pathognomonic of a rectus sheath hematoma, usually from tail in the inferior epigastric artery. Now, we sometimes see this when abdominal incisions have been made, and you can injure this thing pretty easily. And so it can bleed, and you will see a rectus sheath hematoma when it comes off, you know, the inferior epigastric artery. Occasionally, it seems to happen relatively spontaneously.
And then, what does it mark? If you so, you said superior, right, which comes off where? The internal mammary. So it's a long pathway. So all the way down, and then what does it terminate? The inferior. Yeah, usually it marks the border of the external into the common femoral artery. That's why you're at the junction. So a lot of times when we do, you know, groin incisions, like, you know, that's like, well, you know, I usually get really good extensive exposure of the external iliac artery from the groin. And you know, one thing you always will look for, you know, look for the inferior epigastrix, which usually comes off kind of lateral, and you will look for the circumflex. Branches, so you don't injure them too, because those, in case something, you know, you always have to think about something happens, right? Nothing we do lasts forever. So you do patch, iliac stent, that might go down. So if you go in, you like get all these branches. You know, I've had a patient who we actually injured them by mistake, and a year later he came in with acute limb ischemia. I mean, he was really in severe pain because the stent shut down. Now all these branches are gone, so he had severe pain. But if you preserve those branches, I mean, he might come. He has just claudication, right? If you preserve these branches get really big, huge. And same thing for the inferior epigastrics, right? I mean, if you have a aortic occlusion, I mean, those branches, right? I mean, we usually look at the cast and you barely see them, right, in normal patient. But when you have aortic occlusion, they become really big. And you know, sudden coma, a lot of times you hear a patient had a CABG and then he had cold leg. Really? CABG and then he had a cold leg? How could that happen? Yeah, so the lima was one in a major pathway, so and then now it's being, you know, cut and used for the cabbage. So then the patient had, you know, so I saw one patient when I was actually at the VA, same thing, had a patient has a high AKA and he had the coronary section and then he had the AKA after the coronary section. Because no one realized, I mean, had the coronary section is in PACU, no one's gonna like check pulses and stuff like that. But how could that be? We kind of just talked about it a little bit.
The collaterals through the visceral arteries to the epigastric.
Correct, from the IMA, right? When we talk about the superior hemorrhoidal, the rectal, down all the way down to the profundus. So this patient had extended left hemi, and poor guy, I mean, he has a very high AKA, because really no one paid attention after coronary section that, you know, check pulses or, you know, complain of the leg, and it was game over. So
another time you'll see that. I've seen that too when I was there, mm-hmm. And the patient had coronary section, had a transverse abdominal incision, divided mm-hmm. both the inferior epigastric arteries and bilateral leg ischemia. Another situation you'll see this in is paraparesis. Occurs relatively suddenly, and they're going to go this incredible neurological workup. Look at the spinal cord, look at the brain, they can't find anything, and then somebody feels the pulses in the groin, but the pulses are diminished. It's ischemic. It's usually acute on chronic. Truly acute, you really don't miss. Acute on chronic aortic occlusion, sometimes you can miss that because it's a little more subtle. But aortic occlusion, it can present with bowel ischemia, it can present basically with paraplegia. And sometimes these patients languish for a long time before any of the medicine service feels a pulse and calls us.
All right, so let's say a patient has femoral occlusion. How are you going to make your incision to expose the femoral artery? You can't feel it. Ultrasound? That's actually very good. Who said ultrasound? That's actually very good, right? You can, I mean, why not? You ultrasound, mark it, and make incision. That's actually very smart. Let's say you don't have an ultrasound. Okay. And then, so what's the magic number we're looking at? So you just make it in the middle between the two? Say it. Two-thirds, one-third, yeah. So one-third, two-thirds, and then basically make your incision and find the inguinal ligament and eventually get all the way down and find your vessels. But ultrasound is very good. I mean, you know, same thing for carotids, right? I mean, you see all these patients that have carotid, you know, big incisions. I mean, but these days, you don't have to do that. You just make them, you know, put the ultrasound mark where the bifurcation is and make your incision on top of it and, you know, have the patient leave with a really small incision. And same thing for the femoral. Why not? Yeah, that's actually a good idea.
So in a skinny patient, you can often feel, okay, so you can lean pretty hard and you can kind of roll the artery backwards and forwards and you can sometimes feel, and in an obese patient, you have a prayer of being able to do that. Yeah. And the other thing that sometimes helps you if you're in the hybrid room is you can x-ray them, you can see calcifications on the wall of the blood vessel.
Yeah. So let's say if we're going to go about individual. So I guess we talked about that.
All right. We're at the end.
Oh, is that right? All right.
Yeah.
Maybe not. Oh, it looks like I hit something. Yeah. Yeah,
okay,
I know.
There you go.
So
this is where you're gonna live.
Yeah.
This is your life.
This is, yeah, exactly.
40 years. that little space right
there. Yeah.
So. Nice to know something about it.
Yeah. So what's unique about the sartorius? Do you guys know? It's the longest muscle in our body. Yeah, very good. Okay. So, and we use it a lot. You know, we don't call plastics to do our sartorius flaps. I do some rectus flaps too myself. Before you use the sartorius, how would you guys use the sartorius muscle flap? Have you guys done one? So typically what you want to do, so I'm assuming this is the left side. So basically you want to go all the way up to the joint and basically transect it. And then you're trying to mobilize it, but you want to be careful because actually the perforators come in laterally. So you want to, as you're mobilizing, you don't want to basically take too many perforators, usually more than three maximum. Otherwise, you might have an ischemic sartorius. And then basically you mobilize it, you flip it over, okay? You just flip it over and then basically suture in. So basically the supply comes off the profunda. So if you have a patient with no profunda, then you're probably not going to use it, right? Because once you start mobilizing some of these perforators, it's probably going to die. Okay. Meanwhile, the rectus femoris muscle is actually based off the SFA or femoral arteries, and you can use that maybe instead, or maybe a rectus abdominis or some or gracilis or some other muscle. But also sometimes, you know, when we have redo groins, you want to go through the same groin. Actually, sometimes what we do a lateral approach to the profunda, where we actually go lateral to the sartorius and move it up, and then basically dive in, and then try to identify the profunda that way. But what's the problem with that approach? Something you have to really look for it and make sure you don't injure it. The nerve, right? Remember the, what is it, navel? Yeah, it's been a while, but yeah, that's. But basically, that's one way you can approach it. So lateral, or you can do just medial to the sartorius muscle. But remember, sartorius is your friend. Don't damage it during your exposure.
So if you make an incision in the groin, and you see muscle.
Yeah. Are you in the right plane?
We typically see no muscle. So if you see muscle, where are you? Medial or lateral?
Lateral.
You're usually lateral. You almost never see, I don't know if I've ever seen a pectineus in my entire life, to be honest with you. So you're usually lateral. So now you got to go medial in order to be able to get to it.
Yeah.
This shows that.
Just the saphenous. Yeah.
No, I was going to talk about the femoral nerves. Go forward one. So, who knows about the anatomy of the femoral nerve and why on earth would we care about the femoral nerve? What happens then? So, first of all, where is it formed? How does it get down here? And what happens to it down here? These are all really important things for us to be aware of. Okay, Amy, no? Part of the lumbar plexus. Okay, the lumbar plexus, L234 are the segments that make the femoral nerve. Where is the femoral nerve inside the belly? It's inside the psoas muscle, okay? That's where it forms inside the psoas muscle. Now, sometimes we see retroperitoneal hematomas. You will see all of the retroperitoneal hematomas, because everybody see them, they're going to be calling you. And sometimes those retroperitoneal hematomas are bleeds inside the psoas muscle. Then it's a big, nice, round thing. Sometimes they're diffuse in the retroperitoneal space. I personally think the big, round ones are the ones that are most dangerous because it compresses the lumbar plexus. Okay? So, same idea as we went through with the hand. You're consulted because they're worried that they've got a femoral nerve palsy. How are you going to test it?
Dorsiflexion.
Dorsiflexion of your head.
Your foot.
Pardon?
Your foot.
Yeah, you don't even need to go that far down.
Yeah.
Okay, that's mainly sciatic nerve when you start getting down in your foot. What does the femoral nerve supply? Yeah, it supplies your rectus femoris, your iliacus, and psoas. And so what does it do? It flexes your hip. Okay, so the patient lay in the bed, put your hand here, flex them, pull out. If you can do that, femoral nerve motor-wise is intact. Sensory, where's the femoral nerve that we need to know about?
Lateral.
Yeah, anterior and lateral, okay? And so, but you know, the problem with that is, you know, after you've made incisions and things have been growing, there's always these little patches of numbness. Almost every time you make an incision, the patient will tell you you've got a big piece of numbness down below. We divide the branches of this femur, they're little branches all the time. So you want to make sure that they can do that, so you test here and make sure that they grossly motor and sensory function intact. If it's not, and they go retroperitoneal hematoma, you got to operate on and decompress this thing. It's just like the same idea that Eric was talking about up here with the median nerve. Those are the things we've got to pick up. Those are the things when you call us and we go, hey, is the nerve intact? And you say, yeah, we come in the morning. Okay, Mrs. Smith, lift your leg. And she like lies there with this floppy leg. Oh my gosh, you know, that's a bad evening for us, actually. Now, the other part of this is, so the femoral nerve only exists for about 2 to 3 centimeters below the level of the inguinal ligament, and then it divides. It starts dividing in anterior-posterior division, and it divides up into these branches that are going to the rectus femoris, the vastus medialis. So it's varying. You almost can't divide the femoral nerve in the thigh. You can divide the branches, but you can divide the whole thing basically up inside the abdomen. As it comes out in that space between the psoas and the iliacus. So that's the important thing about the femoral nerve is usually a femoral nerve palsy doesn't occur at groin level. It occurs more proximal if you're going to injure.
Yeah, operating on those psoas hematomas, and it's not fun. But if you have to, you have to sometimes for that reason. But so what is this? So important for us or not really? So what do you have? What you have in medial, lateral? What is it? And inferior, superior? All the above? These are important. It's an important collateral pathway, right? From you see a lot of patients with palpebral occlusions, and usually they're just claudicants. That's because of this collateral pathway. So is this the most common area for occlusive disease? Femoral popliteal. Tibial more common? No, usually it's femoral popliteal. I mean, tibial, because usually, if you have one that's occluded, usually you're okay, right? But femoral popliteal, yes, and also part of it because it's an area where there's a lot of tension, compression on that area. That's when we first started doing stenting, people were worried about fracture, and it does happen, especially in the adductor canal, that area, because there's a lot of compression and tension on that area. So,
let me show one other thing. So the sartorius has been cut away there. So the sartorius normally runs from here to here. And it lies on top of the SFA. And the subsartorial canal is a space that we utilize all the time. That's how we make a tunnel when we're tunneling the femoral popliteal bypass graft, is we exploit that space underneath the sartorius, because that's where the SFA runs, and we can run grafts and things like that right up alongside it. But the saphenous nerve runs in the subsartorial canal, okay? And then exits where sartorius inserts. Anybody know what it inserts?
Pes
anterior. Oh, man. What is the pes anterior? That's good.
Three muscles insert there.
Who's saying it? Stand up, man, shout it out, man. They're either going to be proud of you or detest you.
Yeah.
So it's an added one.
Sartorius gracilis semitendinosus.
It all inserts
right here. And sometimes we see it when we're making a popliteal incision, and we can divide that. And so the saphenous nerve exits just at the inferior border of the sartorius here and goes down to medial side of your big toe. If you divide, it's one of the reasons and it runs with the saphenous, it joins the saphenous vein down there and runs to the medial side of your big toe. And if you divide it, it makes your big toe numb, or part of your big toe numb. And it's one of the reasons that, by and large, when you're doing saphenous vein ablations, you don't do the whole length, because if you do the whole length, you kind of injure the saphenous nerve. It's not the end of the world, but it's damn irritating inside the shoe if your toe's numb, the inside of your toe's numb. Mm. So there's all sorts of little things, on here.
I thought of something else to
profund
say.
Profund is your friend for the rest of your life.
Yeah. Right. I mean, yeah. If you have a profunda, right? I mean, you can always keep a leg, or maybe get away with a BKA. But if you have a profunda, right, that's a problem. AKA, and maybe even AKA, high AKA and might not even heal, right? If you don't have a profunda. Sometimes we have to even, you know, in a sick patient, just do like a patch or something, reverse the profunda so they can heal an amputation. But it beats a hip disarticulation, right? I mean, hip disarticulation, if you look at some of the data, even like in cancer patients, which are young, healthy, I'm not talking about vascular disease, and has a high mortality and morbidity, right? Like 40-50% or something.
My posterior view is, what's that big yellow thing? Sciatic nerve. Do you care?
Yeah.
We ever operate in the sciatic nerve?
Amputation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you do an AKA, we got to find that sciatic nerve, and we got to clamp it. And there's an artery to the sciatic nerve that runs along it, so you got to clamp it and you got to tie it. The other situation is a posterior approach to the popliteal artery. Conveniently here, they actually didn't bother to put the nerves in here.
Yeah.
Right? They're in the popliteal space. So we're making an incision down there. We're looking for the contralateral and the tibial nerve. They're all in that space, and you don't want to injure those things.
Well, there you go. Well, that's really showing the sural artery. So what is that? That's cut here. Yeah. Anterior tibial, that's very good. Tippy trunk and posterior tibial and the peroneal. So let's see. Do you guys know what this muscle is coming across here? No. Popliteus muscle, yeah. So it's, you know, sometimes when you have the entrapment syndromes, so sometimes actually popliteus muscle might be compressing on your popliteal artery and you have to, you know, release it. So they simplify this picture quite a bit here, yeah.
A young person comes along with normal arteries and claudication symptoms. I mean, one of the things you've got to consider is popliteal artery entrapment syndrome. And you can get the vein entrapped, or you can get both of them entrapped. And occurs with a variety of different anomalous muscles that occur in that space. Now that's one of the situations they're going to go a posterior approach. You want to show them how you make the incision up there?
So, do you guys know what lazy S? Lazy S incision? Why do you do that? Closure, contraction. Maybe so you can avoid some contraction in the knee, right? And they heal better. So, usually, when you go, I mean, if you talk to a plastic surgeon, they say whatever, but usually medial go basically across and come lateral here. But again, if you talk to some plastic surgeon, they say it doesn't matter. Lazy ass is a lazy ass, but that's, I think, what the book describes it. Basically, so it heals better, have less contraction. I've rarely done it. I had actually a young girl come with popliteal vein entrapment, and then didn't look that bad, but we basically just released the popliteal vein and she got better after that. But
so what they're taking out is the common peroneal nerve runs along here, okay, and goes down to the neck of the fibula. So when you're doing this exposure, a typical incision is like that, and like that, and you're looking for the common peroneal nerve and the tibial nerve. The tibial nerve you're going to have to deal with, the common peroneal nerve you may not have to deal with. But they're all very important. Now, how many Doppler signals have you got at the ankle? Who wants it? Your turn.
At the ankle?
At the ankle.
Yeah. Two.
So give me that.
So the PT?
PT. Okay, so your PT you're going to see here, and we'll show you a little bit later how to find that. What else?
You can also get the peroneal.
Okay. So that's not two.
That's
three. So the three? You need me a third?
Three, no. You get the AT.
Okay, so AT or DP. The posterior tibial, and if you listen to the lateral malleolus, you can often hear that. This is the keep us in bed at night signal. This is why you got to be able to find that, because all we want to know is the Doppler signals down there. That means we can stay in bed and deal with this the next day. And so you're going to look for the posterior tibial, you're going to look for the dorsalis fetus, and you're going to look for the peroneal. If you find the first two, you don't need to worry about the lateral.
We talked about some of the...
Okay.
Exposures. Are we going to do some exposures later?
But this is the anterior tibial artery. You can Doppler the anterior tibial artery along its entire length in the anterior compartment. So this idea, you don't just have to look at the areas we traditionally look at. You can trace these arteries, you know, where they're reasonably superficial along the entire length. You can trace
the posterior tibial into where it divides basically into the medial lateral plantar arteries down into the foot. Likewise, I meant to say this earlier on, but because we Eric showed you the picture of the digital artery, you can Doppler a digital artery all the way out on either side of your finger all the way out to the tip. And sometimes that's important for us. Patient comes along and they've got an ischemic digit. We want to know if there's digital arterial flow down into it. Is this diffuse disease of the arteries or this embolic? If you're listening here, you got black tip of your finger and you've got signals here, you almost got the diagnosis at that point in time. I mean, they're not occluded, they're open, and it's probably something embolic that you're looking at. Same thing on the toes, you can basically do the majority of those. Amy?
No.
Sorry.
So do you guys know which, when you expose the AT, which are the two muscles you're going to expose it? Which one is this? That's the anterior tibialis muscle. Extensor. Digitorum. Longus, okay. Now, if you're going to, so the hallucis, right, there's extensor digitorum hallucis. Actually, if you're going to expose it more distally, that you might come across the hallucis. And for sure, if you're going to expose the dorsalis fetus, you're going to see it, right? You guys know what this like thick white thing that comes across here, you have to resect to get to the dorsalis fetus? Extensor retinaculum, yeah. And then obviously they have the, you know, usually you have communication between the anterior tibial and posterior tibial. A lot of times, you know, you see people have a wire looped all the way around and ballooning on that area for patient with tissue loss. But obviously, we've it's something that we've done. I think we kind of talked about it a little bit. So let me see. So yeah, talk about the saphenous basically coming around the. So the perforating veins, you guys know about the perforating veins?
Yeah, connecting deep.
To connect deep suppressor. So we used to use, you know, there's different, you guys know the one in the I guess you can kind of see it here, but they're called Cockett's perforators, the one in the lowest ones. There's 1, 2, 3. We stopped actually using that terminology because they really come off a different length. So in the past, when I was in training, you say, oh, patient has a Cockett 1. But, you know, when you go into the ablation, it was really hard. So now we actually measure how far the perforator is from the medial malleolus. So it's 5 centimeters, 6 centimeters, 7 centimeters. So we actually kind of stopped using that terminology, Cockett 1, 2, and 3. We just basically say how far it is from the medial malleolus. But basically, you have perforating veins all the way up. You have Boyds, and a bunch of them, dots and perforators that kind of, you know, basically connect the superficial to the deep. And obviously, don't forget the cephalofemoral junction, right? The cephalofemoral junction is with a valve, it has a valve, right? Cephalofemoral junction valve. How about the popliteal vein? Lesser saphenous. Where does the lesser saphenous drain? Lesser saphenous vein. In the popliteal. There's actually also saphenopopliteal junction. Right? Same thing, saphenofemoral junction. We have the saphenopopliteal and has a valve too. And usually, where does the lesser, if you're going to harvest it for a bypass, where would you make your incision for the lesser saphenous? Between the heads of the gastroc, right? That's where you'll find it, between the heads of the gastrocs, and then basically take it all the way out. And usually, there's a vein which is called the vein of Giacomini. I don't know if it's here. Basically, it's a vein that basically kind of connects the lesser saphenous to the greater saphenous. It kind of wraps around the knee, and you see a lot of these patients have lateral bronchiectasis. You can see this like big vein coming wrapped around the behind of the leg. And again, here a lot of times, you know, you see these patients with varicosities and they had ablation. You know, even you treated the main saphenous, but your anterolateral and your anteromedial, they actually might become bigger over time, and sometimes you have to maybe either go in or ablate them or take them out for these patients. So, so even though you treat the main saphenous, but they could have issues with the other ones getting bigger.